How do you want to isolate your product? Well, if it's an intermediate, you can always try to telescope it. And then that way you avoid the issue. And that works as long as the impurities that are present don't impede the subsequent processing downstream. Lyophilization, pretty sweet. You don't have to worry about final form, right? You don't have to worry about polymorph. And if you're making an injectable, then a lyophile may be a nice way to go. Spray dry. Spray dry technology is a big deal these days because so many formulations are being developed for spray dry technology. It's really changing the way that we consider what would be an acceptable drug substance. You can precipitate out the goods. Now, precipitate, a precipitate in general is something that has is formed rapidly, it has small particle size, and it's not necessarily of high quality. And so we want to avoid the precipitations. Precipitations often happen when there's a rapid quench, a rapid addition of the anti-solvent. And we want to stay away from this as much as possible. Crystallization allows you the best chance to control the levels of impurities that are in there, the final form, and the particle size. And there's a whole host of approaches to get a good crystallization carried out. In my mind, people all too often overlook the power and the benefit of spending a little bit of time to find a good crystallization of the goods. So I highly, highly recommend this. There are some really excellent books and papers out to study that aspect. As organic chemists, one of the things that's really incumbent upon us is to anticipate the impurities that are going to be present in our process streams. And these can either be from side products, or contaminants, or byproducts. How do we deal with things like this? So I put up here a coupling with a boronic acid. And the problem is that with boronic acids, especially heterocyclic boronic acids like this one, that deboronation occurs, and you generate the material with the hydrogen over here in place of the boron. Now, obviously, if that happens, you have lost the capabilities to do the coupling that you want. And deboronation is generally slower than transmetallation, which gives you the product that you're looking for. But you always have to consider the deboronated impurity that can result. So Steve Buchwald's group took a look at this, specifically the deboronation for the coupling that I've drawn up here. And the sweet thing to me is that they got an excellent, almost virtually quantitative yield after only 30 minutes at 40 degrees C. So really sweet to get this done. And the difficulty, of course, is that with this particular boronic acid, it's prone to deboronation. Now, you can take a step back from this and go, hey, Neil, they put in 1.5 equivalents. They ought to be able to get a good yield. OK, that's true. I recognize that. But there's still, you could, as process chemists, we would probably take this reaction and tweak it and certainly see if we could minimize what was going on. Okay, so anticipating impurities that could be around. This then would be a byproduct, the deboronation. You've run a reaction in acetone. Under acidic or basic conditions, you will wind up generating our old friend mesityl oxide. Now, you look at that and recognize that this is going to be a soft, except soft nucleophiles for addition here, 1,4-addition. So mesityl oxide is also present in methyl isobutyl ketone because that comes from acetone with dehydration and then hydrogenation here of the double bond. So anticipate what's going to be around in your solvents. Well, it's the acetone or MIBK, mesityl oxide. In methyl ethyl ketone, there's a small amount of t-butanol. The toxicity, t-butanol is actually more toxic than what you might expect if you look at the toxicity data in the literature. And why would t-butanol be around in methyl ethyl ketone? Because of how it's generated in the gas phase. And so if you read about the generation of things like solvents, you can anticipate that, yeah, from isobutylene, methyl ethyl ketone eventually is generated, I believe, from isobutylene. So this is something that would occur. Methane sulfonic acid, going back to the story of nilfinavir mesylate, and the great difficulties that Roche in Switzerland had, there is found in methyl mesylate in industrial grade methane sulfonic acid. Now, why should that be in there? You could probably sit down and draw some pretty interesting hand-waving mechanisms. Purified pharmaceutical grade methane sulfonic acid has less than 5 ppm of methyl mesylate in it. But if you can figure out how it is that these reagents have been generated, you may be anticipating some of the impurities that would be in there. Lead, an impurity in copper oxide. Who would have thunk? Well, you have to take a look for such things and figure out, do I want to get the lead out of my process streams by buying a more expensive, more highly purified grade of copper oxide, or do I want to get it out in other, do I want to remove it further down the road? One of the things that has posed a problem is the level of NOx, nitrogen oxides, in gas, nitrogen. Now, if you use a very high flow sparge of nitrogen to dry your product, and it's a primary amine or a secondary amine, you may well be forming some diazo compound here that could be quite toxic and not what you want. So again, as process chemists, it's our job to really anticipate what the impurities could be that are in our process streams, regardless if they come from the reagents, the solvents, the gases, just have an awareness of what is going on. So the importance of thorough analyses, it's usually not appreciated until someone gets bitten. And it's very important to have a good collaboration with the analytical chemists here. I have a couple examples to show for structures here. You guys have probably read about these recently. These are compounds that the CNE News has talked about them, but I think it's worthwhile to go through them and talk and discuss them. And again, to drive the point home, single crystal X-ray analysis is your best, most definitive way to do things. Yes, you can use high field NMR analyses to as a proof of structure for your API, but when you get down to it, the best, most definitive route is probably going to be a single crystal X-ray. So Kim Janda's group, Scripps, took a look at this particular reaction here, which was cited in a 1973 Beringer patent, in order to generate the linear tricycle. And this is what was claimed in the patent. And so Janda's group, working independently, went through the synthesis and found that what was generated was not this linear tricycle, but the angular tricycle. And so what was claimed in the patent was actually not the bioactive compound. This is the bioactive compound. And they determined this because things didn't, because when Janda's group made this material, it did not show the bioactivity. So the way they did this was through unambiguous syntheses. And I think in the elements of time, I'm not really going to take a whole lot of time to go through this, but you can look at this later on if you wish to convince yourself that yes, indeed, these are different ways of getting to the goods. Depends on whether or not you displace here or acylate over there in order to get to the product. So it's two different ways of doing it. Same starting materials, different sequence in order to get to the goods. So the structure was misassigned. Now, okay, 1973, their analytical capabilities in 1973 are not nearly what we have now. That is very true. However, even in 1973, they could have gotten a single crystal X-ray to know for sure what they were dealing with. And if you, Janda's group argued that you would expect this to be the product, not what is shown, because this is the most electrophilic. This is more electrophilic, the more electrophilic carbon. And statistically, you consider that you have twice as many of these as you do this. And this is probably the more nucleophilic nitrogen anyway. So wouldn't you expect that to be the product? Well, regardless of whether or not you would expect one to be the product or the other one, certainly we have our own biases, it was determined definitively that by X-ray that which one was indeed produced. Now, Janda's group went one step further in this, and they actually purchased what was claimed to be ONC 210. And lo and behold, it had a different, it was a different regio isomer. And this, again, was determined by single crystal X-ray analysis. So this was purchased from the outside. This is what was sold as ONC 210. Buyer beware. Okay? But you can say, well, buyer beware, but on the flip side, if you've purchased something, don't you have the responsibility to go through it and make sure that what you purchased is indeed what you wanted? So similarly, bosutinib ran into difficulties in this regard. So here is the basic structure of bosutinib, and an arrow group goes on the nitrogen. Here is the goods. You can see that it was derived from an aniline. But what was purchased as bosutinib is the compound with the arrow group shown here. Now, this material was used in laboratory studies. Didn't get into people from what I have read. So, good. If you take a look at this molecule, you see that there's a plane of symmetry through here. So these hydrogens should give the same signal in the NMR unless you have some interaction with the nitrile. So if you think about it critically and took an NMR of it, wouldn't you expect to be able to see if it was this or this? Certainly by proton or by carbon NMR, you would think that it should show up as being distinct. And I guess one of the bigger concerns is that if this compound, if the bosutinib regio isomer had been prepared from this aniline instead of the desired aniline, doesn't that mean that the wrong structure was around for the aniline that could have been in the commercial side chain and used for other things? So again, buyer beware, but you also have a responsibility to make sure that you have what you want to have. impurities can be very difficult to remove, especially colored impurities. And I see a number of people here groaning and shaking their heads. And sometimes we just kind of hope we can fold our hands and walk away from the difficulty, because colored impurities in particular can be really difficult to remove. So the example that I put up here struck me because of the different ranges of colors depending on whether or not you have the type of electron donating group you have here, the electron withdrawing group on the other side of the molecule. These compounds were generated for inks, for reprintable paper. But what struck me is the fact that if you put it into a polar solvent, you generate this Witter ion and the color. And if you remove that solvent, you wind up getting rid of the color. So it's a curious thing, but it also kind of underscores the notion that if you want to use a color specification for your goods, then specify the solvent, the concentration, maybe even the temperature, the wavelength, you know, the coefficient, how much extinction you want to have at that particular wavelength. Otherwise, it's kind of one of these warm, fuzzy, feel-good sort of specifications, right? It's brown or it's not brown. It's brown or it's yellow. But if you really want a color specification, define how it is that you are going to analyze for the color.